Big Encounter Church. How's everybody today? Good to see you. Y'all stand and worship with us this morning.
The weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. Who in the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. My God will never fail. No, my God will never fail. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Oh, 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 yeah.
Come on, we sing. There's power.
There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. Every war he wages, he will win. No, I'm not backing down from any giant, 'cause I know how this story ends. Yes, I know how this story ends. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. Yes, for the battle.
See your victory, for the battle belongs to you.
stars. As the Spirit was moving over the water, Spirit, come move over us. Rest on us. Rest on us. When you feel this room,
Good morning, Encounter Church. Can we make some noise for Jesus this morning? Celebrate his name, lift him on high. So glad to see you guys today. Welcome any new people that we have here. We are so happy you're here and can't wait to get to know you. We do have these Connect cards here. You'll see those in the seat back in front of you. You can fill those out, and that way we can keep you updated on anything new here happening at Encounter, just so we can kind of keep you guys in the loop there. Also, you'll see a prayer request. That's a spot where you'll fill out anything that you guys need prayer for. We do believe in the power of prayer here, and we want to intercede for you and be sure that, you know, those things are being lifted up that you feel that you need prayer for within your family, within your life. We want to be doing that for you. If you're online, we're so glad you're here too. We have not forgotten about you. You can actually text CONNECT to 501-510-6020. That way you can have your information to us so we can keep you updated. And also text PRAY to that same number, and that way we can be praying for you as well. So we have our Heart for the House special offering coming up here soon in the month of June. This is just where we take an additional offering to further the kingdom within the community and also to do upgrades within the house here. And so last year, due to your generosity, we were able to actually upgrade the eKids area. And if you guys have been back there, it is awesome. And so we thank you for your generosity and taking that step, because filling that into the next generation is an amazing thing, because they're what's next. And so it's this June, but we've got these little pledge cards here. You'll see those all throughout the sanctuary. So if you'll grab one of those and just pray and see what God puts on your heart, we'll be doing that this June. So going into our offering, you'll see four ways on the screen behind me. That way you can offer up to the kingdom. And so I just want to take a look at one of the verses here that was on my heart. It's Matthew 6. 19 through 20. It says to store up treasures here on earth, where moths eat them and rust destroys them, and where thieves break in and steal. Store your treasures in heaven, where moths and rust cannot destroy, and thieves do not break in and steal. And so what this meant to me is that, you know, the things that we receive in this life, materialistic, just money and stuff like that, it is all temporary. You know, eventually, you could say it has an expiration date. You know, it's going to go away, no matter what. There's nothing that you can do to really preserve it. You might be able to make it last a little bit longer, but it's not going to last forever. But when you take things and you put it towards the kingdom, that makes it eternal. Whether that's your money, your giving, or just even you serving, or maybe speaking the gospel to somebody. You know, that's sowing into the kingdom and causes your riches to last forever in that way. So I just want to take that in mind as we have the ushers come forward. I'll go ahead and bless the offering through prayer so we can all bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, I just thank you for today. Thank you that we have an opportunity to join in fellowship and worship you and get to know you better. So grateful that you are a living God and that we do feel your presence. We do see evidence in our life of you moving. And we thank you for always being beside us. You know, even if we weren't maybe looking for you in certain moments, you have always been there. And so we thank you for that. So I thank you for all the people on the worship team and that they use their talents to glorify your kingdom, Father, and guide us in worship. And I thank you for the word that you've given, Pastor Jeff. May we have open ears and open hearts to receive your word, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I never wanna leave.
Oh, I'm not here for blessings. And Jesus, you don't owe me anything. And more than anything that you can do, I just want you. I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. And I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. No. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. It's Jesus, you don't owe me anything, and more than anything that you can do, I just want you. I just want you, and nothing else, and nothing else. Nothing else will do. I just want you. And nothing else. And nothing else. Nothing else will do. I just want you. And nothing else. And nothing else. Nothing else will. I just want you, and nothing else, and nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you, and nothing else, and nothing else, nothing else will do. Don't owe me. And more than anything that you can do, I just want you. And you're all we want. I just want you. And nothing else. And nothing else. And nothing else. I just want you, and nothing else, and nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you, and nothing else, and nothing else, Jesus, nothing else. You are we want. Nothing else, nothing else, Jesus, nothing else, no, I just want you, nothing else, nothing else, nothing else will do, I just want you, nothing else. Nothing else, Jesus, nothing else will do. I just want you, and nothing else, and nothing else, and nothing else will do. I just want you, and nothing else, and nothing else. Nothing else will do. I'm caught up in your presence. I just want to sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. And Jesus, you don't owe me anything. And more than anything that you can do, I just want you.
Hallelujah and amen. Amen, amen, amen. You may be seated. Thank you so much for worshiping with us. We're going to have a short video and we'll be back with you shortly.
Good morning, Encounter Church. My name is Brandon, and here are this week's announcements. First time here, take your Connect card to the Welcome Center. We have a free gift for you.
Mark your calendars.
Our first 2022 Summer Worship Night is coming. Join us Sunday, June 5th at 6 p.m. at our Springs campus for a night of worship, followed by a fun after party in the courtyard.
Change is coming.
Teens is moving to Thursday night. Turn up, make some noise. Beginning June 2nd, youth will be on Thursday nights at 6:30 p.m. Text youth to 501-510-6020 to receive a summer schedule. We can't wait to see you. Actions Conference is coming. If you are a student from 7th to 12th grade and you haven't registered for camp yet, what are you doing? Text ACCESS to 501-510-6020 for further information, and registration closes May 31st. Email Emily at encounterchurch.tv to sponsor a student. Make sure to meet some of our staff members at the Welcome Tent, weather permitting, at the Springs campus and in the back of the auditorium at the Village campus immediately following service. We can't wait to meet you and to answer any questions that you may have. VBS is on its way. July 18th through the 21st from 5:30 p.m. to 8 p.m. at our Springs campus. Save the dates. Encounter Church, Thank you so much for joining us this morning. It's time to dive into the Word. If you will, pull out your Bibles, your notebooks, and let's lean in and hear what God has to say through His message today. We love you, and we're praying that you all have an amazing week. Do so.
Attention. Transitions. It was all for nothing. I'm a failure. My whole world is turned upside down. Hope. Light. Go and wait. Dawn is on the rise. Mary, doubts are quieted. Hope begins to whisper.
And I love you too, bud. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I like when he says whisper. Look at your neighbor and say, welcome this morning. Good to see everybody in the house of the Lord today. Anybody glad to be here on a Memorial Day weekend? Yeah. Thankful for our country today. Thank you for all of the people who have went before us. We honor anyone in this room today. If you've served in the United States military, if you're there, would you just raise a hand this morning? We could see and recognize you. Over here to my left, guys, give it up over here. Thank you guys so much for your service. I heard somebody say, I love this guy. Well, if you don't know me, my name's Jeff. Last name Manning, just like the football players, but I don't like Eli, but I love Peyton. And I am the campus pastor at Hot Springs Village Encounter Church. We are one church, but how many locations do we have, everyone? Two locations, as Brandon said, Deuce. We have two locations, and we also have our online crowd today, our e-family who joins us from literally around the world. So we greet everyone who is here today joining us on the World Wide Web. But guess who my favorite folks are? You are, because guess what? You're standing right here in front of me, and I have a lot to say in very little time. So look at your neighbor and say, brace yourself. Brace yourself. We are in the middle of our during the end of our series on 50 days, and we've been looking at it every week, John chapter 21, and afterwards. And so we're talking about what happened from Easter Sunday, which was the Passover, all the way till next Sunday. Does anybody know what next Sunday is? Next Sunday is, everybody say Pentecost Sunday. That's that 50 days from Passover to Pentecost. And so we're going to be wrapping up the series next Sunday morning. And then Sunday night, we're going to be having a phenomenal worship night that you will not want to miss. So if you love praise and worship and spirit infilling, next Sunday night's going to be your night. It's going to be absolutely a blast to be here. So 50 days, we've been covering just a few passages of Scripture, because after the resurrection of Jesus in those 50 days, we only get about five and a half chapters. We did a little trivia with the first service this morning, and everybody smiled at me. They were horrible at it. They didn't know. So, you know, or do you guys want to be challenged? You want to be challenged? Let's be challenged. So we got into, how many chapters in the Bible are in the book of Matthew? 28, my man. How about Mark? 16. Luke, 24. Book of John, there's 21 chapters, but John covers chapters 20 and 21, and then the book of Acts, before Jesus ascended into the heavens, we have about a half a chapter. So this entire seven-week series is covering just 5.5 chapters of the Bible. And this morning, I'm going to be turning my attention and your attention to the book of Luke. And so if you have your Bibles, we're going to go to the book of Luke. And you also can have it on your phone, and we're going to probably put it on the screen behind us because we have such an awesome tech team back there, don't we? Everybody give it up for the tech team back there. Woo! So we're going to begin going to Luke chapter number 24, and we're going to be talking about the road to Emmaus. How many have ever heard of the road to Emmaus? How many of you have no clue what the road to Emmaus is? And if you have, awesome, that's where we want to be at. So we're going to try to keep it all to where we're talking to folks who understand it, folks who don't understand it. So what you're having is Jesus has died on the cross. He has risen again. And we're going to find two guys who are walking down a road. And since we're nearing the end of our message series, I thought maybe it might be appropriate for us to sing the 1992 hymn from Boys to Men, End of the Road. Does anybody know that one? Do we want to join hands and sing? Although we've come. I'm just joking. Keep on going. No, I can't. I can't. They might want me to come sing on American Idol or something like that. So. Still, I can't let go. No, I'm just joking. Okay. So we're going to be talking about the road to Emmaus. And Luke chapter 24, and I'm going to just be reading from verses 13 through 21 out of the New International Version today. It says, now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. And as they talk and they discuss these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. Everybody say, uh-oh. We're going to get to some of that here in a few minutes. And he asked them, what are you discussing together as you walk along? And they stood still. Their faces were downcast. And one of them, named Cleopas, asked him, are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know these things that have happened here in these days? Jesus asked, what things? About Jesus of Nazareth. So everybody stop there. Anybody see the kind of the little weird situation that's happening here? He's asking about himself, and they don't know who he is. And so he says, what are you guys talking about, and what things are you talking about Jesus of Nazareth? He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. And the chief priests and the rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death. And they crucified him, but we had hoped that he was the one who is going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all of this took place. And everyone say amen to the reading of the word. Anybody ready just for a little bit of a preaching before you go off to your lakes today? How many of you come to church this morning because you need to hear from God? Amen. Does anybody come to church to hear from God? I told the first church, I don't know why people come if it was just to be a social event, because I can get socializing at so many other places I go to. It's the truth. I socialize, man, a lot of places, but when I come to church, whether I'm preaching or, everybody understand, I like preaching too. I like to preach, and I like people to preach to me. And so everybody say, brace yourself. Let's get ready. I mean, you guys are already a hotter crowd than the first service already, so I'm already liking you guys. Anybody ever went the wrong way before? How many have ever went north and you should have went going south? How about east? I don't even know if this is east or west right now. I'm so confused in this room. East or west? You've went the wrong. Do I have any directionally challenged people in this morning? You'd like just to raise your hands and just confess before God. Thank you. Thank you. And that's what Google Maps are for, guys. And Waze. Does anybody use Waze around here? I'm a Wazer. And so I've went the wrong way a few times. I was one time down in downtown Dallas. I was a teenager. Should have been down there hanging out with my friend Johnny Wells. And we were right beside Reunion Tower. Everybody know the ball in Dallas that kind of lights up. And we were down there and we took a right. And it wasn't until after we took the right that we saw three lanes going under an underpass, traffic coming towards us. We had went down a one-way street, and we were in trouble. And next question, has anyone ever had someone turn their backs on you? Yeah. Maybe some of you are there. You've turned your back on someone else. And I'm asking that question to start our morning message because Cleo and his friend, is it okay if I call him Cleo instead of Cleophas? I don't like the name. Cleophas is a terrible name, right? Cleo is just so much easier to say. And so I'm going to say Cleo and his friend, you see, they were headed in the wrong direction. They were leaving Jerusalem, and everybody needs to understand, quick context, Jerusalem is where it was happening at. It's where the Passover and the party was at. It was the city of promise that Jesus had talked about. And Jesus had told them again and again, on the third day, I'm going to rise again. And guess what day Cleo and company decided to leave? They didn't even decide to hang around the entire day. They're headed back to Emmaus. They're headed the wrong direction. And they had turned their backs upon the promise that was coming to them. Because Jesus, when he says something, everybody smile if you have any teeth this morning. If Jesus, when he makes a promise, guess what he always does? He comes through on his promises. And Jesus had told them, I'm going to rise again on the third day. And Cleo and company decided to start walking away and turn their backs on Jerusalem, headed the wrong way. Why did they do that, Encounter Church, second service? They did it because their hopes had absolutely been shattered. They had watched this Jesus of Nazareth die on Friday, and they did not see a future. And everybody understand this morning, when you do not see a future, you do not see faith. Has anybody ever been there this morning where you went into a place where you did not see a future in your life and you were sitting around going, what is next in my life? I'm here to tell you this morning, you have a future. Look at your neighbor this morning and say, you have a future. Come on, look at somebody else and say, you got a future. Now somebody say it out loud. I know there's just a few of us. Let's say it loud. I have a future. Woo, I like it. I have a future, and they didn't see their future. So guess what? They were going home, Sandy. They picked up their marbles and said, we're headed back to Emmaus. We're going to walk away from Jerusalem. And the entire time, I know you guys were paying attention to that text. It says that they were talking about all the things that had just happened. What do you think they were talking about? You think they were being real positive in their conversation? Mm-mm. They were just, man, just going along. Their jaws are all jabbering, and here comes Jesus joining on the journey. And that's a great J alliteration for you if you didn't pick that up. They're talking about all the things that had just occurred. And here comes Jesus up beside them. And the Bible says that he kept himself from them. They didn't know it was Jesus. And I love what Jesus starts doing. He starts asking them, He starts saying, what are you guys discussing together as you walk along? Do I have any Southerners in the room right now? What's a good way of asking that question? Say it. What you doing? Do I have any Northerners in the room this morning? I had a few this morning. We lived in New England for 8 years. They like to say the word you guys. Look at your neighbor and say, you guys. You have to make your mouth real wide at the end too. You guys. What are you guys talking about? And so, need to be crystal clear here. Jesus doesn't ask questions because he needs information. Everybody understand? God knows everything from beginning to end. Remember in the book of Genesis, this is a little side Bible study here for you, but he gets into the room with Eve or Adam and says, Adam, where are you? Eve, what's this thing that you've done? He goes to Moses. Moses, what's that in your hand? He looks at the other prophet, says, prophet, can these dry bones live again? Asked question after question, but he always knows the answer. Sometimes, if I can just be frank with you this morning, sometimes Jesus asks questions just to try to elicit honest response from us. Because until we get honest with God, guess what? You can't get honest even with yourself. Oh, that was already good preaching right there. Thank you. That was good already. And some of us, we just need to begin to get honest with ourselves. And so Jesus walks up while these guys are moaning and groaning and complaining and talking about all the negative things that have happened in Jerusalem. What are you guys talking about? And what's the response from Cleo? I'm going to start calling them the dynamic duo. Cleo and company. What are you talking about? Haven't you heard of all the things that has transpired in these last few days here in Jerusalem? They took our Jesus, they took our chosen Messiah, and they crucified him. They were going off on all the bad things. And when Jesus asked the question, what things? Watch what the Bible says they did. The Bible says that they stood still, and the Bible says that their face was downcast. Now, what does that mean, face was downcast? They were sad. They were upset. They were confused. They didn't really know, because has anybody ever been in a confused state before? Do I have anybody who's confused right now? Put your hands down. Put your hands down. I'm preaching good. The Bible says they were downcast. They were looking at the ground. They did not know how to answer this question because they're bummed. They're frozen. They're stopped in their tracks, and they could not move and talk at the same time. And get this, guys, again, whole other message here that I will get to preach in the future. I know I will. They were standing next to power, and yet they felt weak. They were standing next to the answer and had way too many questions. They were standing next to the hope giver, and yet they had no hope. Cleopas replied, you must be the only person in Jerusalem who hasn't heard about all these things. For you younger generation, you guys remember, do I have an MTV generation here at all? Remember the show Punked? Am I getting punked? How about for some of you older folk? Candid Smile. You're on Candid Camera. Can you imagine whenever this stranger who they don't know walks up beside them and says, what are you talking about? Remember the old show, Different Strokes? I love Gary Coleman. He used to say, what you talking about, Willis? What's going on? They told him about this Jesus of Nazareth. And watch what Jesus asked in verse 19. He says, what things? It's kind of an interesting question, isn't it? When you think about it, because Jesus knew who they were talking about, and yet they didn't know they were talking to Jesus. Verse 19, I'm going to the Message translation. They said, the things that happened to Jesus the Nazarene, he was a man of God, a prophet, dynamic in word and work and word, blessed by both God and all the people. And then our high priest and leaders betrayed him. They got him sentenced to death, and they crucified him. I put it in italics there because the NIV uses the word, they handed him over. That's very key this morning. Everybody say that word. Handed him over. Have you ever felt guilty for something before? That kind of sounds like these guys are feeling a little guilt going on, because they said it was our leaders. It was our teachers. It was our priest. They handed him over. And I'm going to try to make you a little smarter this morning. This is first service, had a good time with this right here. You ready to learn a good Greek word? Everybody say it. Paradidomi. Say it again. Paradidomi. Bump your neighbor, wake him up and say paradidomi. Paradidomi is the Greek word for handed him over. Our leaders handed Jesus over. And I want to make that point because the word appears a bunch in the New Testament. Judas betrayed and handed Jesus over to armed soldiers. The armed soldiers handed him over to the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin paradidomized him, handed him over to Caiaphas. Caiaphas handed him over to Pontius Pilate. Pilate handed him over to Herod. Herod handed him over to who? Back to Pontius Pilate. Pontius Pilate had handled Jesus so much, he had to wash his hands. And then the Bible says that then Pilate handed him over to be crucified. He paradidomized. And you see, sometimes when these things happen, when things are handed over, these guys were literally saying, Cleo and his friend. We always point out that we always think it's Cleo and another guy. Everybody understand that there's no biblical text that says it was Cleo and another guy? Oh, are you ready for it? Does anybody want a little extra credit here? Go to the book of Luke and you'll see where the Bible says there were a few people standing at the cross. There was Mary, the mother of God, Mary Magdalene. Then the Bible says Mary, the wife of Cleopas, one letter off in the Greek spelling. Some theologians believe that it was Cleo and his wife who were the two disciples on the road to Emmaus. Just for a little bit of fun. And these guys said, hey man, we saw our master handed over. And when he was handed over, our hope was handed over. We had hoped we were, and now we're headed home. We had hoped, we wanted things to be different. We had hoped he was going to break all of our chains. And sometimes we hope that God does things. And how many have ever been in the situation where you hoped for something and it didn't occur? Am I talking to a real church with real people right now? Are we that real perfect church around here? We're a real church. Sometimes we pray for things and we ask for things and sometimes we don't see the answer. And some of us have been there in life. And I'm not going to try to be too upfront here, but I feel like I really need to. Have you ever been to a place where life hits you so fast it takes your breath? Life comes so fast that it's like a violent altercation and you don't really know what to do. Put yourself in the place of Cleo and company. Everything that they had hoped for had now been handed over. And the Bible says, and now it is the third day since it has happened. Jesus said he was rising on what day? Third day. We already talked about this a little bit. We're gonna backtrack a little bit here, okay? Third day, and these guys don't hang out for the full 3 days. Because understand that they almost missed what God was intending for them because they were on their way. Don't you think maybe they should have called up Verbo? Hey, do you guys have an extra night here in Jerusalem? Maybe call the local La Quinta, or for you high rollers, the Marriott's. Hey, guys, don't you think we could hang over for one more night and see if God's going to do what he said he was going to do? And yet, right now, there was a generation 2,000 years ago that didn't want to wait for just a little bit longer. Let me preach to the people that are in the room today and for the people that are online. We have a generation right now that sometimes wants to stop short of what God has intended for them in their lives. Well, that's worth a hand clap whether you like it or not. We're on the verge sometimes of some great things, and guess what we want to do? Turn our backs, and we want to walk to Emmaus. It's 7 miles, but guess what? It's easier than what I had to deal with in Jerusalem, and we're headed in the wrong direction time and time and time again. And sometimes we're just not persistent enough for what God wants in our lives. Can I hang out there for just a little bit longer? I'm going to anyhow. Persistent widow, look it up sometime. Bible says that there was a judge who did not fear God. He did not fear man or woman. He didn't really care what anybody thought. And this widow kept coming to this judge, and she would say, grant me justice against my adversary. And she would keep telling him, grant justice for my adversary. And she would get out her phone, if they had phones in those days. And she would start texting this judge, grant me justice against my adversary. And then she'd go on Facebook Instant Messenger, and she would say, "Grant me justice against my adversary." Then she would get online, and then she would leave really long voicemails on his phone. And let me just stop right here. I said it this morning as well. How many realize, quit leaving 17-minute voicemails for people, okay? Stop doing that. That's a good word for somebody today. Say it all real quick and get out of there. She's leaving this guy all kinds of voicemails, and she bugs the everlasting snot out of him to the point to where the judge says this. Somebody open up their ears. She says, the judge says, "The lady's bothered me so much, I'm going to grant her what she wants, so she'll leave me alone." Jesus turns around, and guess what he says? Jesus says, "Will not God bring about justice for his chosen ones, the ones who cry out to him day and night?" Some of you, look at your neighbor and say, be persistent. Keep walking, and keep walking in the direction where you can hear from God. You see, it's not always easy being on the road to Emmaus. And that's where these guys even said, some of our friends went off to the tomb to check it, and they found it empty, just like the women said. But they didn't see Jesus. They don't know what's happened, and they're confused. We talked about it just a few minutes ago. Sometimes confusion can bring around some crazy things. These are not my originals, so if you like them, they're not mine. If you hate them, they're not mine. But some people, they're as confused as a chameleon in a bag of Skittles. And some people are so confused, they're confused as a mood ring on a paranoid schizophrenic. And some people are confused as a round pizza in a square box with triangle slices. They're confused. They're confused. And guess it. Here, guys, they almost missed it. These guys almost missed it as they're walking and jaws are jabbering away from Jerusalem, away from the promise. And sometimes, again, I'm just trying to be upfront with you. This is what I feel in my spirit. Sometimes we as the body of Christ, sometimes we miss what God has for us because we leave the promise way too soon. God has something for you and I. You see, they were expecting this great Messiah. They were expecting this new king of Israel. They were thinking something to the nature of sovereign Jesus and strong Jesus and super Jesus. And sometimes you and I think that way. Sometimes we feel like, I remember watching the old Batman series with Adam West many years ago, and when they would fight, it would say boom and pow and wham, and you know, that's what would be the signs. And sometimes we think Jesus has to come on the scene with a halo on his head, with the voice of Morgan Freeman bellowing from him, and being strong, super powerful, sovereign Jesus. And guess what? Sometimes Jesus shows up as sneaky Jesus. That's good preaching right there. Look at your neighbor and say, sneaky Jesus. We don't like to think about Jesus being sneaky. He wasn't born what? Think about it. Even in his birth, no big metropolitan city of Israel, born in a palace. No, born to teenage kids in a grotto on a backwoods town called Bethlehem. That's sneaky Jesus. Sneaks away from his mom and dad. Read it. Sneaks away from his mom and dad when he's 12 years old. Don't you guys wish you had this problem that your kids would sneak off to church? That's good preaching right there, Jeff. Let me say this to you. And if we would create an environment where God's Spirit can reign supreme and miracles and signs and wonders show up, guess what? Your 12-year-olds will try to get to church. Is that good, Chisholm? Thank you. I'm talking to myself too. Sneaky Jesus. Told folks repeatedly, don't tell people who I am. Keep this to yourself. How many times did he reveal himself to sinners and he would say, shh, keep it quiet. Because there's sometimes, let me speak to someone, sometimes, guess what? Jesus has to give a revelation to you and you can't hear from someone else. He sneaks up on you. Snuck up on the disciples in a storm. Remember that? And they all start screaming, ah, it's a ghost. Sneaky Jesus. sneaky Jesus. Appeared suddenly through locked doors. Pastor James preached about it 2 weeks ago. Come through the doors, and there was the disciples. Remember, he snuck back in with Thomas, and the Bible says that they were all fearful. Snuck in on him. Everybody say it, sneaky Jesus. Got up early Easter morning before the sun even came up. Knocked down a couple of Roman guards, pushed away a stone, appeared to Mary Magdalene, who we preached about a number of weeks ago in this series. And guess what? Mary didn't know who he was because he appeared as what? A gardener. Sneaky Jesus. Sneaky Jesus. And I asked this question this morning. What makes you think that if Jesus can sneak up on all these guys and then come creeping up on Cleo, hey guys, what's going on? What are you talking about? Haven't you heard? What things are we talking about? About this Jesus of Nazareth. That's kind of a sneaky Jesus. What makes you think if he can't sneak up on all these guys in the scripture, what makes you think this morning sitting in this room right here on Lakeshore Drive that he might not be sneaking up on you right now when you don't even think? I feel the Holy Spirit right now talking to somebody. You don't even know he's around. And you're sitting here right now going, where's God in all of this? And I'm frustrated. And all I want to do is complain and gripe. And here's Jesus all alone walking right beside you. Sneak up on you. You must be ready because the Son of Man will come at you at a time when you least expect him. That road to Emmaus, maybe it's that avenue of aggravations. Maybe it's that journey that you're on. Maybe it's your boulevard of broken dreams, hashtag Green Day. Maybe it's that highway to hell, hashtag ACDC. You're in a spot in your life where you never thought you would be, and you feel like you're alone. And Jesus is walking beside you, and you don't even know it. I'm closing here. They finally get to their house, which is another reason why I believe it was actually Cleo and his wife, because two guys usually weren't sharing a house in the days of Jerusalem. And the Bible says that they invited Jesus into their home. Follow this. Jesus, the Bible says that Jesus acted like he was going to keep going further. You ever thought about that? He said, they're talking. He breaks out the Bible study for them. He starts explaining to them all the scriptures. And the Bible says they got so excited. They said, come to our home. And Jesus acted like he was going to continue to go on further. Why? Because he's sneaky. Brings them into their home. I love it. He urged them, stay with us, for it's nearly evening. The day is almost over. So he stood with them. And when he was at the table with them, he took bread and he gave thanks. And he broke it and he began to give it to them. Doesn't this sound like something that happened just a few weeks or a few days previous to what had just happened? It's called the Last Supper. Holy Communion. He took bread and he broke it, right? And he gave it to them and said, this is my body. This is the New Testament, the New Covenant. Maybe this morning his body was broken because that's what happened to him upon the cross. He said, my body's broken for you. And when he breaks the bread, that's what happened to their hope. Their hope had been broken. I can't prove this from Scripture, but I think I'm pretty contextually good in this. Everybody smile at me. At least I'm being honest with you. I can't prove this, but I think I've got it right. He sits there. He breaks the bread. He gives the bread. When he gave the bread, in my strong opinion, what did they see? They saw nail prints. And his brokenness. Oh, I feel the Holy Spirit. Whenever he showed them his brokenness, the Bible says that their eyes were opened and they saw him and they recognized him. Do you guys realize this morning that sometimes brokenness is the gateway to your victory? How many have ever been broken before? And we don't like God in those times, do we, Carrie? We get upset at God. We start doing the God, why me? I go to church. I give my tithes. I hug people. I invite people to church. And why do these things happen to me? Because brokenness is often the precursor to the miraculous. often brokenness is the gateway to His glory. Broke this for you. Here you go. And when He handed it to them, their eyes were opened. Would you stand with me this morning? I got a lot more notes and don't have enough time. Breaks the bread, gives it to them. Their eyes were open. They recognized Him. And then watch what He does. The Bible says after He broke it, they recognize Him. What happens next? The Bible says they disappear from His sight. Why did He disappear? Anybody know the answer? Who said it? Who said it? Come here, brother. I got a $50 gift card for you right here. We're in a 50-day message right now. 50 days, I got $50 for you. Thank you, Rob Carr. See, I was sneaky there. Did you see that? I snuck that in on you. You like that, don't you? That was sneaky. That's like Jesus. I'm sneaky. Look at your neighbor and say, be like Jesus. What would happen if you got sneaky on someone this week? You creeped up into their lives where they least expected you and said, Jesus loves you. You put some money in their hand and say, hey, go buy you that tank of gas that you need. You snuck up on somebody. It would revolutionize their lives. Their eyes might be open for the first time, and they may see Jesus, not through all of your glories and all through your happiness and through all those things, but they may see Jesus through your trials. They may see Jesus through your wounds. Stretching the text here to Douglas Harper's dictionary. They were on a trip to Emmaus. Anybody want to read that with me? Emmaus was a biblical town from the Aramaic Hamat, meaning what? I know I'm stretching the text a little bit this morning. Some of you have no clue why God brought you to Hot Springs, Arkansas. Some of you have no reason why you're still in Hot Springs, Arkansas. But guess what? God had a road for you paved to take you where you needed to go, because when you got to Emmaus, then He could show you who He really, really is. In hindsight, all these two were talking about is what happened on Friday. That's what they were griping about, right? Friday. What happened on Friday? I wish they would have listened a little bit closer to what happened in the words. Anybody remember some of the words Jesus used while He was on the cross? Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. It's finished. This day you'll be with me in paradise. I thirst. One disciple was at the cross. His name was John. John writes first person, and John says this. He says, later, knowing that everything had now been finished and so that Scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, I'm thirsty. And a jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it. They put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and they lifted it to Jesus' lips. And when He had received the drink, Jesus said, it's finished. With that, He bowed His head, and He gave up His spirit. Everybody say, gave up His spirit. It's a terrible translation right there. You know what the Greek word there is? Everybody say, paradidomai. I was sneaky. I brought that back on you. Jesus says, it's finished. And what's the word paradidomai mean? Handed it over. You see, they did not take Jesus' life. Jesus... Anybody feel what I'm feeling right now? He paradidomied and He handed it over. He gave His life. No man took it. And today, if you're in this room and you've never made Him the Lord of your life, guess what? Your day is today. Today is your day to paradidomai and hand it over and give it back to Him. Would you bow your head with me? Father, right now, I pray that if there's one person in this room, we talk about the one. If there's one person in this room who's never made you Lord of their life, it is their day. We can pray it. Father, forgive me of sins. Forgive me of wrongdoing. I was walking the wrong way, but today, Lord, I repent. I turn back, and I'm starting my way back to Jerusalem. I'm starting my way back to where the promise is going to be given, because on that day of Pentecost, the Spirit was given to those men. Many people believe Cleo and company were part of that 120 who received the baptism of your Spirit. I pray today, God, if there's that one person today that needs to make you Lord of their life, they could slip that hand in the air, and this is a day of rejoicing in this room. In Jesus' name. God, if there's people here today that they just need to hear from you one more time and show their brokenness, I pray, God, that you would speak into their lives today. Holy Spirit, do what only you can do in this house. Help us, oh God, to hear from you and have our eyes opened. And then, God, when our eyes are open, the Bible says that their hearts burned within them, that we would once again be set to fire and let people know who you really are. And the church say, amen, amen. Look at your neighbor and say, paradidomi. May the Lord bless you, and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you, and may the Lord give you peace. I love you guys. Be back here next Sunday, June the 5th, Pentecost Sunday. Pastor James is going to bring a great word. I love you guys in the Lord, and say it loud, loud. I love you, Jesus. God bless you. You're dismissed in his name. Amen. Amen.